We'll try to cover up this talk with challenges of dyslipidemia management and diabetes, hypertension, CKD, and residual risk. What is the residual risk? I feel it must have been discussed in the last 2-3 days. What are the new lipid targets which have been proposed apart from LDL and apart from statin? We are talking since then. What is the relationship between diabetes and non-HDL, which is our talk, and hypertension, non-HDL, and chronic kidney disease and non-HDL? I don't think that I should be showing these slides. This is known to everyone that basically when you talk about cholesterol and triglyceride, dietary cholesterol and triglyceride, they are not water soluble, and they need to carry in the system through with the help of some protein, and that is what is called as lipoprotein. So lipoprotein basically carries these fats, and this is a structure where you have in the center is hydrophobic core of triglyceride and cholesterol esters. Then you have at the peripheries, which is a monolayer of phospholipid and free cholesterol. And this is the how the apolipoprotein, which is with these lipids. And these are the various classes of lipoproteins, which starts with chylomicron, and then after metabolism, it remains as called a chylomicron remnant, and then forms VLDL, LDL, and then LDL further smaller, denser VLDL, then IDL, then a large LDL, then a smaller, denser LDL, and ultimately HDL. And we know that except the HDL, all other lipids are pro-atherogenic lipoproteins. Now, these are the different lipoprotein classes. So you have chylomicron, which is supposed to be the biggest in size. And where the major lipid is your triglyceride. And these are various apolipoprotein. In that, mainly it is B48. And then I just have learned about ApoE with Dr. Ashutosh. Then you have chylomicron remnant, which is chylomicron and chylomicron remnant remain in the system for a very small time. The size is little lesser than the chylomicron, and it has primarily triglyceride, as also have cholesterol. But then ultimately remnant is more atherogenic because it has good amount of cholesterol in that. VLDL basically have high triglycerides, and it is being reflected that whatever is VLDL is a reflection of the triglyceride in the system, and basically it is hyper triglyceride. Then you have intermediate LDL. LDL is smaller. Then you have HDL and LP little AS. Now, if you talk about all atherogenic cholesterol, which starts from maybe chylomicron up to LDL and even LP little A, it is the apolipoprotein B. Here it is ApoB100, ApoB100, and LP little A also ApoB100. While which is HDL, it is apolipoprotein A, and that is why it is an apolipoprotein B is an indirect marker of the atherogenic lipid profile, and ApoA is a marker of HDL cholesterol. Now, this is how it goes with chylomicron, VLDL, chylomicron remnant, and the black which you see is triglyceride, while the red is cholesterol. So as the molecule becomes smaller, the lipoprotein, the concentration of triglyceride goes down and cholesterol goes up. So this is the non-HDL cholesterol, which consists of chylomicron, VLDL, chylomicron remnant, IDL, intermediate lipoprotein, and low-density lipoprotein. This is an except HDL. So non-HDL is being calculated as total cholesterol minus HDL cholesterol. So I'm sorry for that. There's no animation here. I will have to bear with it. The non high density lipoprotein or non HDL cholesterol has been shown to be superior predictor of CV risk because it contains cholesterol of all atherogenic particle, and that is why we should be now addressing non HDL cholesterol apart from LDL cholesterol. Most of the guidelines are still with LDL cholesterol, but now data is coming up more quickly, and more viewpoints are changing globally, and various guidelines are now advocating to go for non-HDL cholesterol, which is supposed to be one of the simplest way of getting the atherogenic profile of an individual. It is simply be calculated. You don't need to be overall overnight fasting, as being pointed out by Professor Tripathi. But nowadays, even data says that non-fasting triglyceride is also acceptable. So when you talk about diabetes, almost 50% of the diabetic dyslipidemia, they have not achieved their LDL goal. And the data is more horrifying if you talk about one of the ABC goal, and AA is for A1C, B is for blood pressure, and L is for ABC, C is for cholesterol. So it is LDL cholesterol. If you talk about all three goals in a patient with type 2 diabetes in our country, only 27 to 30% of them, they are controlled. Still 70% of them have not achieved their goal. Some of the data says almost more than 50% of them have not achieved their goals. That means their LDL goals have still on higher side than expected. Second issue is diabetes itself causes atherogenic dyslipidemic profile, where you have, though LDL is normal as that of the non-diabetic population, but the LDL is smaller and denser, which is more atherogenic. The particle is more atherogenic. The typical dyslipidemia profile has hypertriglyceridemia, low and low HDL. So you have high triglyceride, low HDL, and smaller and denser LDL. More so, if you have a diabetes and if you have associated hypertension, almost 50% of type 2 diabetes, they have hypertension. And many of them are still uncontrolled. More so, around 10 to 15% of them might be having diabetic nephropathy, around 20%. So you have concomitant diabetes, hypertension, chronic kidney disease, metabolic syndrome. We have found metabolic syndrome is almost up to the range of 70%, 72% in our own data when we have done a study on type 2 diabetic, almost 1,200 patients. And it has its impact on dyslipidemia. Food, we have discussed just enough, and we know that fast food habits in our country is high. We people are high carbohydrate eaters, and our carbohydrate content of our diet varies from almost 60 to almost 80% in some of the population, especially in South India. You have heavy rice eaters, so then you have even in Chhattisgarh, and then also in West Bengal, where a lot of rice, as well as the total total carbohydrate content, which ideally should be around 55 to 60% of the total diet, it exceeds to 65, 70, 75, and sometimes 80%, which itself is one of the reason that you have a problem with control of diabetes as well as lipids. So, and then we have a habit of this HFSS, which is called as high fat, high sugar diet, and this is again a bad thing, when especially in metros, that the high fat and high sugar and low fiber diet is being consumed very aggressively as a fast food. It could be not only pizza and burger, it could be even Indian fast food, it could be vada pav, it could be anything else. Now, increasing the statin dose increases the risk of side effect. Now, everyone knows that we have people are being given statin. And we know, we understand that the targets of LDL are gradually going down. We started with 130, 100, now 70, 55, and now it is even up to 40. So we want to reduce LDL, but then more and more increase statin, there's a risk of having the myopathy kind of pain, and it is not being tolerated very well. More so, it is also apathy amongst our professional that we are not very aggressive in initiating and intensifying the statin therapy. Many of the times you might be knowing some other, the pain or maybe the myalgia or the pain might be because of something else than statin. But still there is a concern on these lines, and that's another issue we have, and that's why the unmet needs. And last but not the least is there is high residual risk of recurrent cardiovascular event. Many of the trials, almost all the trials across the globe of any CV outcome trials, when you talk about statin and you give and you prevent development of any of the CV disease or CV mortality or MACE or anything, still you will find that around 10 to 15 or 15 to 20% of the population, despite having very good control, still they have had MI or spill, they had some or other a bad outcome. And that is called as residual risk of recurrent coronary artery disease or cardiovascular disease. And this is what we are talking about, that what could be this residual risk, which we need to address. The postprandial hyperglycemia was one of the hypertriglyceridemia.
हेलो
हेलो
यस सर योर वॉइस इज कमिंग यस सर योर वॉइस इज कमिंग
सम डिस्टरबेंसेस दैट्स व्हाई या सो व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट रेसिडुअल रिस्क देन सपोज दिस इज अ नोन कार्डियोवास्कुलर डिजीज वाज पुट ऑन हाई इंटेंसिटी स्टैटिन स्टिल पेशेंट हैज एट हायर रिस्क ऑफ हैविंग रेसिडुअल रिस्क फॉर रिकरेंट सीवीडी and which could be different and depending on the person to person, as very rightly being pointed out by Ashutosh just now, that we have even genetic predisposition for, so genes is one, but then you have residual, it could be a residual risk of cholesterol, it could be residual risk of inflammation, it could be residual risk of triglyceride, it could be residual risk related to thrombotic risk. And potential intervention, what we need to do possibly is more aggressive LDL reduction. Maybe inflammation has been pointed out by Dr. Shivshankaran just now, that we should be trying to reduce inflammation some or other mean. Target triglyceride reduction, which is still not being propagated and accepted by most of the global bodies. But we not only should be talking about the fasting triglyceride or normal triglyceride, but an unsaid or unknown a factor of postprandial hypertriglyceridemia, which might be differ from one person to another, again might play another role, which we need to, we don't have any clinical experience of treating such thing, but dietary modification might indirectly helping that particular phenomena inside patients, especially when I saw that, when I shared that it is the resident time of hypertriglyceridemia in the system, which remain, and every 3 hours, 4 hours, you're diabetic, go on eating something. So every time you eat some high fat food, triglyceride goes up. And if you talk about the postprandial state of a human being, especially in our country, almost 17, 18 hours of your day, you are in the postprandial phase. So post-absorptive or postprandial phase. And of course, we have to target the antithrombotic agents. Now, reduction, this is a data which is known to you, around 40 milligram reduction in LDL can actually reduce the major coronary event for 5 years in up to 25%. So even 40 milligram reduction of LDL from the baseline will help you, not necessarily that you should, if you have a coronary artery disease, you should be achieving 40 or 70. Even if you are with the maximum tolerated dose, by reducing 40 milligram will also help. Likewise, you should be more vigilant and more aggressive in treating this case. So when you talk about bad LDL versus low LDL versus very low LDL, so now data says up to 30 milligram is best. And we have some guidelines, ESC guidelines, which must have been certainly discussed in this August meeting. I'll just go through it very, very quickly. Evidence of changing lipid management strategy to focus on non-HDL cholesterol. This is a 2019 paper. And this says, even by aggressive LDL lowering treatment, patients still present a significant residual risk of major adverse cardiovascular event, that's MACE. Non-HDL cholesterol contain all the atherogenic lipoproteins, and many prospective observation study have found that non-HDL was better than the LDL in predicting the risk of MACE. So there are a few bodies which have possibly accepted this particular hypothesis. So there are International Atherosclerotic Society guidelines, there are National Lipid Association guidelines, and National Institute of Healthcare Excellence, that's NICE guidelines. And these are three, four organizations, those who have accepted this, and they have proposed that non-HDL cholesterol should also be one of the criteria of treatment and should be addressed properly after LDL. ACE guidelines, just go through it very, very quickly because this must have been discussed. Risk is more in diabetes, hypertension, and CKD. Diabetes with the target organ damage, maybe it's CKD, especially when you have less than 30, then the risk is very high. And if the total cholesterol is more than 310, this has to be multiplied by 38.7. Blood pressure high, so they're high risk. So they have categorized various risk risk profile, low risk, moderate risk, high risk, and very high risk. And these are the recommendations where you have to keep LDL less than 50, 55 if you have documented ASCVD or ASCD on imaging. High risk when you have one prominent risk factor with diabetes or without any risk factor, or EGFR 30 to 60. So according to various risk profiles, you have to target LDL. Now there is another category which has been added now, extremely high risk group, where ASCVD with the second vascular event within 2 years, you have to target LDL up to 40. So these are things which we need to learn. I will more emphasize on this particular slide, the new target for LDL, non-HDL cholesterol and ApoB. Again, ESC guidelines, they said that LDL, if the risk is very high, should be less than 55. If it is high, 70, moderate, 100, and low, it is now come down to, instead of 130, it is now 115. But what about non-HDL cholesterol? Non-HDL cholesterol, as we know, it is a calculated cholesterol. And this is usually 30 milligram. You have to keep, the target is 30 milligram higher than that of LDL. So when you say LDL target is 55, non-HDL cholesterol target will be 85. When it is 70 here, it is 100. And when it is 100 here, it is 130. So non-HDL cholesterol, they have categorically added this 30 milligram. And this 30 milligram addition in non-HDL cholesterol is basically with the hypothesis that VLDL particle, basically, they represent triglyceride. And the VLDL particle, you see, they are primarily triglyceride and less of cholesterol. The ratio in VLDL particle of triglyceride versus cholesterol is 5:1. So when you say that it is 150 milligram of cholesterol triglyceride in VLDL versus 30 the cholesterol will be calculated as 30, that one fifth of 150, and that is why they have taken 30 as a marker from the VLDL point of view, because VLDL being presumed as a representative of triglyceride. So this is just a score that you have a low, moderate, high, very high, and extremely high. I feel we have already discussed this. So these new cholesterol guidelines, they have been compared with the American College of Cardiology, American Heart Association 14, and now this is ATP guidelines. They say that those who are at lower risk, it should be less, non-HDL cholesterol should be less than 130, moderate risk again less than 130, and high less than 130 again, but very high, it is less than 100. So they have not reduced the LDL here and they have kept it, but this is almost 4 years back. We should be following the recent guidelines where we try to keep it along with the LDL recommendations. Now let us talk about non-HDL cholesterol in diabetes and what are the data we have. This is one of the paper which was of 2007, under treatment of cardiovascular risk factors among person with diabetes in the United States. These adults with diabetes have suboptimal control of cardiovascular risk factors and remain far from the target goal of blood pressure, as I told you, BP, lipids, and A1C, this ABC. And they said that almost 65% of them have not achieved the LDL of less than 100 among diabetics. And around 72% have not achieved the non-HDL target of less than 130. So if this is the situation in US, I feel if we have real good population-based data from our country, this figure will be much higher than what we've got in US. And this is a multivariate analysis where they have non-HDL cholesterol goal attainment. You have achieved non-HDL cholesterol goal as well as you have achieved LDL targets. So both the targets have been achieved in a very high risk population. So association of different variables with achievement of LDL and non-HDL goal for very high cardiovascular risk profile. And it says clearly that it is the non-HDL targets which matter a lot when it comes to cardiovascular disease, especially when it comes to uncontrolled blood pressure and triglycerides. So non-HDL cholesterol goal attainment, its relationship with triglyceride concentration amongst patients with diabetes who have high CV risk, around 2,640 around 2,700 odd patients from Hungary. And they have found that it is the non-HDL cholesterol is also equally important for cardiovascular disease. And these are all co-founders which they have found it to be in multi-logistic regression analysis. Now, this is non-HDL cholesterol is a predictor of cardiovascular disease in type 2 diabetes. This is the strong heart study. This is in multiple phases. And this is one of the study where they have actually taken all Indian Americans. So there are around 13 different geographic regions in US where they have found Asian Indians, around 4,500 women. And the multivariate analysis have indicated that non-HDL cholesterol is a strong predictor of CVD in men and women with diabetes and is particularly indicative of coronary event, as the hazard ratio of highest tertile of non-HDL in men and women with diabetes were 2.2 and 1.8, were higher than those of either LDL cholesterol or triglyceride low in both men and women, and were higher than the ratio of total versus HDL cholesterol. The utility of non-HDL cholesterol in predicting CVD extended over a wide range of triglyceride concentration. And this study suggests that non-HDL cholesterol index may be particularly useful in predicting cardiovascular disease in patients with diabetes. And I'll emphasize that this study was not in American, those were done in US, but this was for Indian Americans. There are 13 American Indian communities in various geographical locations. They have been tested for in this strong study. And this is the various indices. If you see this non-HDL, when you keep it less than 127, the risk of CVD is less. When it is 120 to 60, little higher. And when your non-HDL is more than 160, the risk of having a cardiovascular disease is much higher. So lower is the non-HDL cholesterol. So below 130 here, if we recommend, is better for CV protection and should be applicable for our population also. And here they have also classified cardiovascular disease versus coronary heart disease and the effect of non-HDL cholesterol on CVD adjusted for sex, age, BMI, smoking, study center, systolic blood pressure, A1C, fibrinogen, insulin and albumin to creatinine ratio. So most of the co-founders have been adjusted through the analysis, and that is why it seems it is a non-HDL cholesterol which seems to be a good indicator of coronary cardiovascular disease. And this is a strong heart study, and this is now 3,200 patients. And here you have around 40% men, around 40% men with diabetes, and almost similar women with diabetes. So the total of the total population, they were around 40% of them. They were men were not diabetics. And what it says is the CSD as well as the ischemic stroke by triglyceride and HDL status during a median follow-up around 17 years follow-up. The earlier study was 9 years follow-up. If I talk about this is 2003 publication. It's 9 year study data. And then it is 2018 publication, if I'm not wrong, somewhere. Yeah, it is 2017. So this is 17 year follow-up of the same Indian American population. And they have high risk population as well as the low risk, and their fasting triglyceride of more than 150 was high, and HDL level of 40 men and 50 women as low was considered. And what they found, the CSD free probability is higher if you have your CSD free if suppose you have a normal TG and normal HDL cholesterol, and they have pointed out that HDL cholesterol as well as triglyceride have found to be one of the risk factors. So triglyceride cannot be ignored in this era of statin. So if you have and this is the conclusion from this. This is that was the first slide was coronary artery disease, and this is for stroke. And they say the adult with both high triglyceride and low HDL, low for men 50 and for men 40 and for women 40, and triglyceride more than 150, particularly those with diabetes, have increased risk of incident coronary artery heart disease and stroke. In particular, those with LDL more than 130 milligram may have an increased risk of stroke also. So if you have in combination of low HDL, high triglyceride, if you have additional LDL as a risk factor, then the risk of stroke is further higher. So they have found coronary artery disease as well as stroke, where triglyceride and HDL have been given importance. So when you talk about non-HDL, which also captures the cholesterol in triglyceride-rich lipoprotein, that is TRLs, has been more strongly associated with cardiovascular disease risk than LDL, and is recommended as a secondary target to attend the residual risk, particularly in certain conditions. Example is diabetes, obesity, metabolic syndrome, in toto any key feature of hyperinsulinemia with an atherogenic dyslipidemic profile, including high non-HDL cholesterol, triglyceride, and low HDL. These are the secondary causes of hypertriglyceridemia, which could be obesity, metabolic syndrome, insulin resistance, diabetes, hypothyroidism, renal disease. We'll talk on this, pregnancy and some other illnesses. And of course, diet with high energy balance, even though increased alcohol intake, which Mangesh has just commented on. Increased production of triglyceride-rich lipoprotein in diabetes. I feel this is the mechanism. The liver produces VLDL, which undergoes lipolysis to yield IDL, intermediate density lipoprotein, and ultimately LDL cholesterol in the adipose tissue and muscle. When you have insulin resistance, when Dr. Asutosh Mishra just told about insulin resistance and hypertriglyceridemia, and it is insulin resistance and type 2 diabetes, the LDL cholesterol tend to be smaller and denser LDL, potentially, which is more atherogenic. ApoB, as I told you, is a major lipoprotein component of VLDL, IDL, and LDL. While gut produces ApoB48, and it is actually containing chylomicron. So when it is exogenous fat coming inside, it's chylomicron and ApoB. When it is endogenous fat coming from VLDL, IDL, LDL, it is ApoB. Lipolysis of VLDL and chylomicron by lipoprotein lipase on the endothelial surface produces TRL, that is triglyceride-rich lipoprotein remnant, which is more atherogenic, which has more cholesterol. Most of the preclinical and human genetics have demonstrated various proteins, which include various proteins. I won't be able to go into detail of it, which could be utilized for the therapy in future as a target. TRL remnants are removed from the circulation by liver via LDL receptor and LDL receptor related proteins. So the treatment algorithm when it comes to hypertriglyceridemia, patient who has hypertriglyceridemia, they define and achieve the LDL goal, define the non-HDL goal, exclude and treat secondary causes of hypertriglyceridemia, implement the lifestyle changes. Non-HDL goals, if not achieved despite your 4 efforts as earlier, then you should see whether it is more than around 400 or less than 400 or more than 400. If it is more than 400, your main concern is pancreatitis, and for which again you have to have lifestyle modification. Maybe you can add fibrate because the triglyceride are higher side. There are different recommendations. Some of the recommendations is 500, some say 350, and some says 400. Consider fibrates here or omega-3 fatty acid. We just discussed on this about the reduced citral, and then you can modify the fat, consider the lipid, and if it is considered experimental therapy, if suppose it is further high. Then you have, if it is less than that, then your primary goal is depending on overall CV risk. Again, this was discussed in the panel just now, that you have to first calculate the ASCVD risk. If the ASCVD risk, depending on the ASCVD risk, consider LDL as the first target and maybe consider the fibrate or omega-3 as a second line of therapy. This is European Heart Journal article. These are various trials where they have shown triglyceride lowering might help. This is HHS where you have GEM fibrogel. Here also we hit GEM fibrogel. Then you have BIF, which is bezafibrate, field trial fenofibrate, Accord fenofibrate, and Jellies. We just some of the delegate has commented on Jellies trial where they have used EPA and they have found that there is 19% reduction in CV outcome. And where statin was used along with EPA, and there was a reduction in LDL by almost 25%. Triglyceride was a little less here. But if you talk about fibrates, then your triglyceride lowering is quite good here. It was expected that that here also EPA will reduce, but here something it is only 5%. Possibly the dose which was discussed in Jellies were less. I feel it was somewhere around much less than what was given. Reduce it, you have given, I think, 4 grams per day. Here they have given somewhere around 1.8 or something. Here in reduce it, we have some slides on that where they have used EPA in patients who have high risk of CVD, and statin was continued as before, and there was no significant change in HDL in any one of them when you use fenofibrate here and EPA here. But there is significant reduction of around 18.3% of triglyceride, and also little reduction in LDL. But there was 25% reduction in CV outcome trial when you talk about EPA and statin together. And this is one of the reassuring data coming out from the reduced IT trial. So I'll just spend some time on reduce it trial. This is a reduction of cardiovascular event with ecosap and ethyl intervention trial. Now were around 45 years. There are two group of people. One was high risk patient and another was established CAD. So when it was more than 45 years of age with established cardiovascular disease, it was a secondary prevention cohort. When you had more than 50 years of age with diabetes, with more than one additional risk factor, it was primary prevention. So the drug was used in two group of people, one who had established CVD, so it was secondary prevention, so that they should, and another group was for primary prevention, age was 50 years plus diabetes. LDL fasting triglyceride should be more than 150 and less than 500. LDL should be less than 100, and stable. They should be on statin therapy or maybe ezetimibe. Intervention was EPA was given 2-4 gram per day versus some placebo. Around 8,000 plus patients. Very long term, around 5 years. And the baseline triglyceride 216 and LDL was normal. And this is how the primary endpoint. If you see in the patients who were not having any, they were just high risk patient. So primary endpoint, CV death, non-fatal MI, non-fatal stroke, coronary revascularization or unstable angina was found to be significantly low with the hazard ratio of 0.75, p-value of 0.001 in patient who were given EPA versus placebo. So that is quite reassuring. And this is a secondary endpoint. Again, it was 0.74 as hazard ratio and p-value 0.001, which again signifies that EPA might help in such patient, possibly acting through triglyceride lowering. Cardiovascular risk reduction with the EPA EPA in patient for hypertriglyceridemia. These are the primary composite points, secondary composite points, CV death, fatal or non-fatal MI, urgent revascularization, hospitalization, angina. These are common things. If you go through any of the CV outcome trial, most of the things have been taken care, and everything favors EPA here when you talk about any of the CV risk reduction. Maybe it is morbidity or even death for any cause or death from CV. It was on the favor of EPA. So they have actually they have concluded that the among patients with elevated triglyceride level, despite the use of statin, the risk of ischemic events, including CV death, was significantly lower among those who received 2 grams of EPA twice daily than among those who have not received. So with the same use of statin, there was additional benefit which has been contributed to EPA or omega-3 fatty acid. Let us talk about hypertension and HDL. Now, dyslipidemia and the risk of developing hypertension in working age male population. This is a data from Japan, and they have shown that there is elevated serum total cholesterol, LDL cholesterol, and non-HDL cholesterol. It was with an increased risk of hypertension in Japanese people, Japanese men. This is another slide which has shown the association between clinical cutoff point of each lipid parameter and the risk of developing hypertension in overall study population. So if you see the odds ratio, non-HDL cholesterol for developing hypertension was 1.7 year unadjusted and age adjusted. And if you see, you take all other confounders and if you adjust with multiple cofactors, it's 1.2, almost highest than even total cholesterol, triglyceride, low HDL, or high LDL. If you consider any of the other four lipid disorder, it is the non-HDL cholesterol, which again was considered more than 170 as abnormal. It was found that in both adjusted as well as the unadjusted model, the hazard ratio is higher than any of the risk factor, any of the other lipid risk factor for hypertension, developing hypertension. So this is another message for all of us that we should be targeting non-HDL, which will not only protect from other cardiovascular disease mortality, but also will help in protecting a person from hypertension. Now, this is a long-term association of LDL cholesterol with cardiovascular mortality in individual at low 10-year risk of atherosclerotic disease. So, ASCVD risk is low at 10 years. So, this is a big number, around 36,000 odd patients who from the Cooper Clinic longitudinal study cohort who were at low 10-year risk of ASCVD, less than 7.5%. Followed for 2 decades, 20 years follow-up, almost 26.8 years follow-up, low LDL cholesterol and non-HDL cholesterol of more than 160 were associated with cardiovascular disease and coronary heart disease mortality. So it was a mortality disease observational data where they have found it is not only LDL, but also non-HDL. If it is more than 160, it is a risk factor for those patients who were otherwise at lower risk of having coronary artery ASCVD. And this is again, I feel the same data on CVD as well as CSD. This is non-HDL as we have seen in other reduced IT or some other data. Same is here for stroke as well as for CSD and CVD, cardiovascular disease and coronary artery disease. Association of LDL cholesterol, non-HDL cholesterol and ApoB level with risk of cardiovascular event among patients treated with statin. So patient already on statin, it's a meta-analysis. Among statin treated patient, on treatment level of LDL, non-HDL cholesterol and ApoB were each associated with the risk of future major vascular event. But the strength of this association was greater for non-HDL cholesterol than LDL or ApoB alone. So non-HDL cholesterol still has upper hand versus LDL and ApoB. And this is a meta-analysis where increased LDL is associated with increased risk of future CV event, even if the LDL is under control with statin. So non-HDL cholesterol is important. Chronic kidney disease and non-HDL cholesterol. Dyslipidemia is well-known risk factor for cardiovascular disease. It is common in subjects with chronic kidney disease. Lipid management and treatment would be important for the risk reduction of CVD in those with CKD. Many of the CKDs, they die of coronary vascular disease. And even a person, if someone, I feel most of you are aware, but just to recollect that statement, which long back I heard a wonderful data which says the person of with diabetes with just proteinuria is almost 20 times higher risk of having cardiovascular disease versus the other diabetic who does not have proteinuria. So the early stage of diabetic nephropathy can be a risk factor. The pattern of this, and that's why they have coronary artery disease, very common. The pattern of dyslipidemia in subject with CKD differs from that observed in general population. Non-HDL cholesterol has been reported to be better index of future CSD than other lipids such as LDL. This is the dyslipidemia in CKD. This is a nephrotic syndrome. And this is another study, a lipidomic study, where they have some HDL deficiency, decrease ApoA, increased triglyceride IDL, and so lipid VLDL, IDL, triglyceride, the atherogenic profile that is non-HDL seem to be quite prominently seen in dyslipidemia and CKD. This is non-HDL cholesterol and the risk of CV disease in community failures with chronic kidney disease. And what they have concluded that the higher serum non-HDL levels are associated with the greater risk of CSD in subject with or without, with and well as without CKD, and that this association is greater in subject with CKD than those without CKD. So they have found association both coronary heart disease in both, but those who had CKD it was higher versus the others. And this is a typical graph where you have less than 150, 150 to 190 and more than 90. This is a population where it is a no CKD, while the higher bars are with CKD. So the development of the coronary heart disease, according to CKD status, the non-HDL cholesterol, as it goes up further, the mortality increases of coronary heart disease amongst patients with CKD. So higher is the non-HDL cholesterol, almost four times higher, 4.0 times higher risk, relative risk is almost four times higher here versus 1.5 time when it is less than 150. So non-HDL cholesterol as a predictor of cardiovascular mortality in patient with end-stage renal disease. So these are the patients, non-HDL cholesterol in pre-dialysis serum was significant and independent predictor of cardiovascular mortality in patients who were undergoing hemodialysis. So non-HDL cholesterol may be a useful marker for risk assessment in routine practice, although predictive power of this and the standard fasting LDL should be compared in future studies. But there is at least a guideline that if you do those who are undergoing hemodialysis, end-stage renal disease, even in amongst them, the non-HDL cholesterol might be a guidance for aggressive treatment. Non-HDL cholesterol to HDL cholesterol ratio also found to be an independent factor for chronic kidney disease. This is around 2000 Chinese adults with normal or near normal kidney function at the baseline, and they had around 3 years follow-up, and compared with patients with lower tertile, they have found that non-HDL cholesterol versus to the HDL cholesterol ratio was found to be independent predictor of CKD in this population. There's an inverse association between non-HDL cholesterol levels and mortality in patient undergoing hemodialysis. So if you have higher non-HDL cholesterol, the mortality will be higher amongst those who are undergoing hemodialysis, and that is again because of the cardiovascular disease. And this is the graph which shows the mortality. If you have lower non-HDL cholesterol here, the mortality is the hazard ratio is the all-cause mortality here, and this is cardiovascular related mortality. The higher is the level of non-HDL, higher is the risk of having mortality. The ApoB in diabetes is the structure protein of all pro-atherogenic lipoproteins. ApoB 100 is the only lipoprotein that does not transfer among lipid particle and is the only lipoprotein that could be elevated even in diabetic normolipidemic patient. Thus, it provides the best estimate of total number of atherogenic particles even in absence of hyperlipidemia. So this is a study of correlation between ApoB and dyslipidemia in type 2 diabetes patient and its relation with proteinuria. So we are talking about diabetic nephropathy. The prospective cross-sectional study conducted in 100 type 2 diabetic patient, and it was ApoB was measured using the test. And what they found is LDL, total cholesterol, triglyceride were positively correlated with ApoB, and there was a positive and linear relationship between LDL and triglyceride. ApoB was negatively correlated with HDL cholesterol. These are patients with proteinuria. And this is the ApoB triglyceride rich lipoprotein and risk of cardiovascular event in person with CKD. And this was around 9,000 odd patients with CKD in the study of heart and renal protection. This is SHARP study, and that is 6,240 not on dialysis. Rest of them were on dialysis. And the hazard ratio were calculated. I'll just go through the result. And here they have found that ApoB triglyceride ratio, ApoB triglyceride ratio of TG to HDL and TG rich lipoprotein cholesterol concentration were associated with increased risk of atherosclerotic vascular event in patients who were on were CKD having and or those who have low HDL. So conclude some of the one or two slides, non-HDL cholesterol testing is one of the easiest way. It does not need the person to come fasting. It can be calculated as total cholesterol minus HDL cholesterol. Non-HDL cholesterol in diabetes is simple, cost-effective, and convenient. It does not require 12 hours fasting, which may be risk for hypoglycemia in this patient. Clinician may choose non-HDL as one of the routine measure in everyday practice. I'll strongly recommend it in the lipid profile report of every pathologist or a lab. One should mention non-HDL cholesterol also as one of the part of the report. Many of us are doing it, but all of us should do it more seriously, so at least you have one more marker. To summarize, currently LDL cholesterol is the primary treatment target for lipid-lowering therapy in primary as well as secondary prevention of cardiovascular disease. However, despite achieving the LDL goal, patients still develop recurrent coronary artery disease, cardiovascular disease. One possible explanation for this residual risk could be still high non-HDL cholesterol in these patients. And one should also know that when you talk about LDL, most of the time it is a calculated LDL and we don't have to do the direct LDL. And that can again cause a problem. And high triglyceride again gives rise to lower LDL reports when it is calculated. So one maybe explanation could be high HDL cholesterol, non-HDL cholesterol in these patients despite achieving good LDL target. It is important to measure and treat non-HDL cholesterol in diabetes, renal disease, and cardiovascular disease despite LDL is under control. ATP3 guidelines recommended a non-HDL as a secondary management target for those with triglyceride level of more than 200. However, no triglyceride cutoff was defined by other organization. So we still have are in a gray zone whether it should be utilized and in across the globe, whether we should be doing it as aggressively or whether we should continue targeting LDL and keep the triglyceride as a second target. It's not exactly target triglyceride, but non-HDL as a second target. I feel that makes sense, especially in our country where we have hypertriglyceridemia as one of the risk factor. And there are many studies where they have shown that hypertriglyceridemia could be an independent risk factor for cardiovascular disease. With this, I stop here. Thank you. Thank you very much for.